Hey guys, welcome to another video. The Delta variant of COVID, or B16172, belongs to a viral lineage that originated in India during the intense wave of infections there in April and May. Then it made its way to the UK in mid-April when they started to reopen the country. At that time, COVID cases, hospitalizations, and deaths were dropping big time as a result of the lockdown and excellent vaccination rates. Fast forward to mid-June, and the Delta variant caused a third COVID wave in the UK. As a result, the government is delaying the full reopening until late June. Other countries have taken notice and are preparing accordingly. The UK is a world leader in genomic surveillance, and couple that with lots of COVID cases, they were able to do some great analytics in their studies. Thankfully, the studies were showing that the COVID vaccines, which in the UK are Pfizer and AstraZeneca, they remain effective against the Delta variant, as long as people had both shots. And I talk more about the Delta variant and the vaccine studies in this video here. So far, we don't have data on the Johnson & Johnson and Moderna vaccines, but we should get that data soon. Presumably, the Moderna vaccine will have similar efficacy as the Pfizer vaccine, since they're very similar mRNA vaccines, and they have similar efficacy against COVID in general. Hopefully, the J&J vaccine will have the same efficacy against the Delta strain as it does other strains. So what about those who are unvaccinated? Their risk depends on many factors. You still have the usual risk factors for COVID: older age, male, type A blood, high blood pressure, diabetes, obesity, heart disease. But how does that risk change based on previous COVID strains compared to the Delta variant? Based on the limited data so far, this risk is only going up. The Delta variant in Scotland doubled the risk of hospitalization for those who contracted COVID. The Delta variant is about 60% more transmissible than the already highly infectious Alpha variant, that's also known as B117. So Delta variant COVID cases are doubling every 11 days in the UK. In the US, it's soaring in the Midwest and the Southeast. There's a company in California called Helix, and they are conducting nationwide genomic sampling. They found that the proportion of cases caused by Alpha fell from more than 70% in late April to around 42% as of mid-June, with the rise of Delta driving much of that shift. So far, data from Helix suggests that the Delta variant is spreading faster in U.S. counties where less than 30% of residents have been fully vaccinated, and that's compared to higher vaccinated counties. If you look at the country as a whole, the Delta variant made up 10% of COVID cases, and as of the recording of this video, it's already at 21%. The numbers have been doubling about every 2 weeks, so it's likely to become the dominant strain in just a few weeks, especially now that we've lifted restrictions. According to the CDC, as of June 23rd, two-thirds of the adult population in the United States has received at least one dose of the COVID vaccine. Now, based on recent polls, 20% of American adults say they won't get vaccinated. The proportion is higher in certain groups, like younger age, those who live in rural areas, and white evangelical Christians. The most recent models, based on the Delta variant being 60% more transmissible, along with a predicted 75% of eligible Americans getting vaccinated, means that we're probably looking at an average of 2,000 plus deaths per week during the fall and the winter. Then you combine that with kids less than 12 who can't get the vaccine, at least not yet, who'll be back in school at that time, and that's a bad outlook. But based on that model, if 86% of Americans are vaccinated, that might avert over 10,000 deaths by the time you get to December. When we talk about risks with mRNA vaccines, talking about Pfizer and Moderna, we know that they can cause some side effects in the first 2 days. That's the immune system at work for you. And there's a very small risk of allergic reactions, which are almost never serious. But what about myocarditis, meaning inflammation of the heart muscle? Or pericarditis, inflammation of the sac that covers the heart? Myocarditis and pericarditis often go together. So thanks for watching, and I'll see you in the next one.